the redeemed.
And we are in the army of the Lord.
We've been washed in the blood,
and we are going forth.
There is nothing that can stop this mighty moving force. With a shout of praise, a two-edged sword, every stronghold of bondage must fall beneath our feet. Every prisoner,
of the blood-bought church, washed in the blood of the Lamb. Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise?
When upon the clouds of heaven Christ shall come to earth again, will the world be glad to see Him? Weeping, there'll be praying when our Lord Just wait for
James chapter 3, I will be reading verse 1 through 18. The Bible says, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For many things, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold, how a great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God." Verse 10, "Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh? Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out a good conversation, his works with meekness and of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace." So what we're looking at tonight in the subject of James chapter 3, he's talking about the words that we speak. Now there are some words that we speak today that are used to encourage and to build up one another. And then there's other words that are used to bring discouragement and to bring other people down. But today, in the 21st century, not all of our words are spoken verbally. Sometimes we are not courageous enough to speak to someone face to face, and a lot of times we do not have the courage to tell someone something over the telephone, so we shoot them a text message. Or if we really want to say what we think about someone, we go to Facebook.com and we update our status and we really tell the world what we think about this individual. And everyone can read it, including people at church, including our family. So now that I have kind of set the foundation this evening for this interesting subject, I want to preach to you on the subject, and I'm calling the title of this message, "Watch Your Mouth, AKA Postings." For those of you who do not know what AKA stands for, it's abbreviation for also known as. Watch your mouth, also known as your text messages or what you put on Facebook. So that's what I'm going to preach on tonight. Would you lift your hands toward heaven one more time and let's pray for God's anointing on this message. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you for the promises in the word of God. Lord, I pray that in this message tonight, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, that you would open up our mind and our ears to receive the truth of God's word. God, that you would speak into our hearts and into our lives wisdom and knowledge of the truth of your word. And Lord, we give you praise for it. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The words that we speak are very powerful. And apart from the redeeming work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, all we can ever do in our speech is harm with the words that we say. And that is why we need godly wisdom to use our words wisely. The words that we speak, the messages that we text on our cell phones or post on social media also reveal the state of our hearts. It also reveals what our true character is about. The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." In Galatians chapter 5, verse 25, the Bible says, "If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." And so time and time again throughout the Word of God, we see that the tongue is being addressed. And James is denoting an entire chapter in his book on the subject of controlling the tongue. And when we consider the words of Jesus, we see why the tongue is given such an extensive treatment. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 34, "O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh." How we handle the tongue is a great indicator of what our hearts look like before God. In other words, the words that we speak is always an indication of our character, of what we are made of. And in James chapter 3, we see that the tongue has power. And by nature, the tongue is hypocritical. That means that it can only be transformed through the help and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You know, the tongue does have power. In verse 1 through 8, he's talking about, he says, "Brethren, be not many masters." In other words, this is talking about experts or those who are teachers, those who possess great knowledge. He says, "Knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." So if you are a pastor, if you're an evangelist, if you're a minister of the gospel, if you are working in the church in some area of ministry, teaching Sunday school, the more that you know and the more that you allow God to use you to speak words of wisdom, the more accountable you're going to be held. Pastors are held accountable on what they preach and what they do not preach. Teachers are held accountable on what they teach and what they do not teach. In verse 2, "For many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and is able to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which, though they be so great, are driven of fierce winds, and yet they are turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter of fire a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison." Now, when you look at the tongue, everyone in this room, I trust, has a tongue. The tongue is a very small organ when compared to the overall size of our body. But at the same time, the tongue accomplishes a lot. Now, I brought a few props up here at the front, and as big as our platform is, I knew I wouldn't have room, so I had to put them inside the pulpit. All of my props I have is right here in my hand. Now, I believe in object lessons, but these are small objects, and I want to show you how something so small can accomplish a great deal. Now, does anybody see what I'm holding in my hand right here? Now, if I was to step off the platform, you might be able to get a closer look. This is what I call a Wi-Fi USB. Now, some of you may not know what it is, but what it means is I can take this little piece of plastic that has a piece of metal on the end of it. I can plug it into the side of my computer, and instantly, if there is a internet signal in the building, that computer, although it does not have Wi-Fi built into it, it enables that computer to connect to the network without running any cables. Some time ago, we had purchased some computers here at the church. We bought one for my office, and we put one in Sister Pat's office. And I was trying to figure out, how are we going to connect her desktop computer to the internet, because desktop computers are not equipped with a wireless internet. And so somebody came up with an amazing invention and invented one of these. And so I plugged one into the back of her computer, and it saved me a ton of money and a ton of work from having to stretch a cable from one side of the building to the other. And so we just plugged this piece of plastic in the back of her computer, and now she's able to check the church bank accounts. And because of this, we're able to put our church services on the internet and broadcast our services live. Something so very small, but yet it accomplishes a large job. I have something else here. It's very small. This is a video card. Now, it doesn't look like much. This is an even smaller piece. It has hardly any metal on it whatsoever. Looks like a piece of plastic, not worth anything. But I can put this little card inside the video camera in the back, and we can record a two-hour church service on this card. We bring three of these every Sunday. We have one for Sunday school, one for Sunday morning service, and one for the Sunday night service. During camp meeting, it was quite fun because the service lasted longer than what one of these cards would hold, and so we had to use two cards for one service. But something so very small that you can put in your pocket, I could probably put 15, 20 of these in my pocket and say, hey, I've got 20 church services right here in my pocket. It's amazing, isn't it? Something so very small, but yet it does a lot. Now, this little gadget here, to me, this is a priceless piece of equipment. Every message that I have ever preached since the year 2010, all of the sermon notes is on this. When I was in Bible college, every project I worked on in Bible college is in here. There's videos of pastors, there's camp meetings, there's revivals. I have a Southern Gospel concert recorded on here, and it's getting to the point that after about 2,000 or 3,000 files on here, it's getting very full. And so I'm going to have to get another flash drive or thumb drive. But it's very small, but yet it accomplishes a lot. Now, I know there's other types of equipment that is not necessarily small. Many of you that work on farms, or you work on a job that uses large machinery, for example, let's say a tractor or a vehicle. It's a large piece of equipment, but it relies on something that's very small in order for it to work. Without a spark plug in that ignition, it's not going to fire up. It relies on something small to determine whether it's going to work or not. Something very small can accomplish a large task and make a very big difference. And see, there's a lot of people in the world today, a lot of people in church, they want to be heard. They want to have a story to tell. And what better way to be heard as a child of God than to be a teacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to be a Sunday school teacher, to be a pastor, to be an evangelist, to be a witness. But yet James is telling us that we need to consider the power of our tongue. In other words, we don't need to be hasty in pushing ourselves forward to try to be in a position where our tongue is constantly going to be used, because the tongue is powerful, and as such, the tongue is going to experience a stricter judgment. In verse 1, I want to look at that again, and this time I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers in the church, for we who teach will be judged more strictly." That is why it is so vitally important for every preacher, for every pastor, evangelist, and Sunday school teacher, and anyone who has any kind of place of authority in the ministry, to use extreme caution, because people depend upon what you tell them. People are watching the way that you live. They're listening to the words that you say, and they're watching your activity on the internet, and they watch you in public, and many lives depend upon what we do. So we must make it count for the kingdom of God. And so if we can control the tongue, we can control the person. And I believe even more than the tongue, we've also got to control our minds. And James is telling us in verse 2, if we can control our tongue, that we would be perfect, and we could also control ourselves in every other way. And he's also using some other illustrations here. In verse 3, he's telling us we can make a large horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in its mouth. Some of you were here back in September, and we had Pioneer Day the last Sunday in September. And after having an amazing old-fashioned service and a wonderful meal, we had some people in our church that had brought their mules, and I went out there for the first time in many years and climbed up on one of those mules, and the mule I rode, he was pretty good size, and this mule was a lot bigger than I am, but I was able to control that mule. I was able to make this mule go the direction I wanted to go. I was able to make this mule go the speed I wanted to go, and to slow him down and to make him stop. How did that happen? It's because I was holding on to the reins, and those reins was connected to a metal bit that was placed in that mule's mouth. And if I wanted to turn right, all I had to do is pull to the right. If I wanted to turn left, I just pulled to the left. If I wanted to stop, I just pulled back and that mule would stop. It's the same way with a large ship. In verse 4, he's saying that a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. Likewise, our tongue is very small. Big things are accomplished by a very small tongue. And James compares the tongue to a spark that sets a forest on fire. One small spark can start a fire. I remember when I was in eighth grade, we had a huge wildfire that began to spread across the northeast parts of Van Buren and out into the rural areas of our county. And it all started because some teenagers thought it would be fun to see what would happen if they lit a piece of bathroom paper and threw it out the window as they was going down the road. And hundreds of acres, possibly thousands of acres, burned, including people's homes, because of a small little area that was set on fire. But our words are alive. The things that we say to other people or about other people, the things that we write in our text messages or the things that we type and post on social media, those words can either build and encourage and they can lift up, or those words can tear people down. Those words can bring hurt and those words can destroy. Jesus spoke some words, and the words that Jesus spoke was alive. In Mark chapter 11, verse 11 through 14, the Bible says, "And Jesus entered into Jerusalem and into the temple. And when he had looked round upon all things, and now the eventide was come, he went out unto Bethany with the 12. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree afar off, having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, No man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it." I want you to notice in verse 14, it says, Jesus answered the fig tree. Now, this fig tree did not speak to Jesus verbally, but it had communicated that it had figs by the green leaves that were on it. You see, when a fig tree is going to have figs, it's going to have leaves to show that figs are evident. A fig tree produces green figs before the leaves appear, and if no figs are produced by that time, then the tree will not have any figs throughout that year. And so this fig tree was professing something that it didn't even have, although it was still too early for figs. And so when we use our tongue to speak God's word in faith, it brings the Holy Spirit into action. In Luke chapter 4, when Jesus was tempted of the devil for 40 days, it was the word of God that Jesus spoke, and he used that to defeat the enemy and his temptation. In 1 Kings chapter 17, Elijah had prayed and declared that it would not rain until he said so. In Exodus, when Pharaoh refused to let the people of God go free, Moses spoke and he said what plagues were going to take place. And all of these were spoken by the mouth. They were spoken by faith and according to God's perfect will. When we place the Word of God in our heart, the Holy Spirit can bring it forth at the appropriate time to accomplish and complete a total victory over every obstacle that we face in our life. And more than anything else, the tongue displays the state of our heart. Humanity alone cannot control the tongue, because it's what's on the inside of our life. It's our character. That is what is revealed in the outside. It's what's revealed in our appearance. It's what is revealed in our speech, just as the Word of God says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. We must know that the tongue can be hypocritical. You know, it's amazing the things that the tongue does. The tongue can be used when speaking the Word of God. You can use the tongue when you're spending time in prayer or praising and magnifying God. The tongue is used to bring words of encouragement to other people. But then the tongue also has its faults. The tongue can curse. The tongue can lie. The tongue can be used to criticize and to swear and to speak words of hate. So we see that both good and bad behavior come forth from the same tongue, from the same individual. And James is telling us that this kind of character is inconsistent with a life that has been redeemed by Jesus Christ. And as a Christian, you and I should be growing closer every day, and we should be growing more consistent in our speech and in our character. In other words, we need to become like Jesus Christ. See, the tongue, like many things in our life, it has its good side and it has its bad side. And as I said a few minutes ago, it's not so much the control of the tongue, but the object in question is, what is feeding our tongue? What is in our mind? What are we doing with our minds? I've heard the stories of preachers years ago and some today. And you've heard it preached here before, and we used to preach very strongly against television. And we need to understand that TV itself is not the cause of evil. We have a television in the back of the sanctuary. That television does not have the authority to do anything evil. We have a large video screen here and a projector. It's not going to automatically just start putting movies on there that we do not need to be seeing. But an electronic device can only do what we program it to do. I personally think that churches and ministries should utilize this kind of equipment to put services out so people can watch and where they can be part. And in that case, the television and the internet is an amazing tool, and it helps the church to accomplish part of the Great Commission of Jesus Christ. But what we understand is, it is people who choose to watch programs. It is people who choose to listen to or read about things and watch things that are inappropriate for a child of God. And when that happens, the television and the internet is now being used in a negative way. I've seen it happen before on a Christian film, where this man was addicted to looking at things on the internet that was inappropriate. And so what he did, he just took it all out, took it outside, took a baseball bat, and just destroyed it. Well, if we wanted to destroy our television, and if we wanted to destroy our computer and just take it out and just beat the smithereens out of it, but we don't change our hearts, then all we've done is just waste a lot of money on electronic devices, and we didn't do anything to our inward character. Now, not to sound political, but it's the same way with these gun control policies that we're seeing in our nation today. You see, the gun is not to blame for shooting someone. It's the person that's holding it. It's the one that's pulling the trigger. I like what Senator John Kennedy from Louisiana said last Tuesday morning on Fox News. He said, what we need is not more gun control, but more idiot control. And I also like what he alluded to. He said in Louisiana, where he's a senator, he said you can give a kid a gun, a rifle for their fifth birthday. They'll unwrap it. They'll take it outside that morning, go shoot a squirrel for breakfast, turn around, go shoot a deer for lunch, and then go kill an alligator for supper. Why not? It's Louisiana, home of Duck Dynasty. But it's a condition of the heart. It's not the device in question, but it's the heart. This can't do absolutely anything when it's out of my hands. It's just sitting there. It's just there. But it's when it's in our hands, that's when we control what it's doing. So we need to understand the source of the redemption of our tongue. Redeemed speech only comes from godly wisdom that's being imparted to us. Worldly wisdom leads to a tongue that's been infused with bitterness that will show itself through bragging and through denial of the truth. But godly wisdom, when we put the word of God into our life, his wisdom is going to lead our tongue to speak words of peace, to speak words of knowledge, to speak words of truth, to speak the word of God. A lot of times, worldly wisdom is earthly, it's unspiritual, it's demonic. Worldly wisdom shows itself in a bitter envy that is accompanied by bragging and a denial of the truth. Some time ago, I told some of you the story of my next door neighbor's grandkids. They love to brag on themselves and their family. I was out in the backyard doing some work in the yard and overheard some of the kids next door talking. Our neighbor's granddaughter had one of her friends over, and she was showing them everything that her grandparents had put together in the backyard. And the little girl's friend spoke up and said, "Wow, your grandparents have a lot of neat things." And the little girl kind of chuckled and said, "Yeah, well, you know, we're pretty proud of ourselves around here." And I thought, my goodness, that girl is very conceited. But if the truth be known, that type of character is when our tongue is in its default position. In the natural, this is how people act. In the natural, our character leads to disorder and every kind of evil. But when we have godly wisdom, that's what comes from above. Godly wisdom is characterized by all that is pure, by all that is peaceful. It is godly wisdom that leads our life to peace. That's why it's so important that as a child of God, we watch our mouth. We watch what we put into our life. We watch what we listen to. See, if we're going to be all that God wants us to be, if we're going to accomplish all God has in store for our life, we're going to have to watch our mouth, making sure that the words we speak line up with the word of God. In Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21, the Bible says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof." You see, words are like containers. You can only put so much in a container. And whatever you put into a container, that's what you're going to be pulling out. Now, on Thanksgiving Day, we had a lot of food that was left over, and so we filled a lot of containers with ham. I had a lot of leftover ham and a lot of leftover chicken and dressing. Now, I'm not going to shove all of that ham into one container and all that chicken and dressing into one container and then a few weeks later go in there and pull out a bunch of Mexican chicken out of that same container. It doesn't work like that. What you put in is what you're going to be pulling out. Do you understand what I'm saying? Whatever we put into our life, whatever we allow our life to be fed, whatever we allow our spirit to be fed, that is what is going to be coming out of our life. See, words are like containers. Words can either bless or words can curse. They can discourage or they can encourage. Words can wound or words can make whole. Words can destroy or words can bring life. You know, the words that we speak can have power. The words that we hear can stay with us for a long time. Whoever made up the saying that says, "Sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can never hurt," they didn't know what they were talking about. Words can hurt. Words can build up, and words can hurt. The words that we hear can stay with us. For example, the words we hear in the morning can cause us to make a success of the day, or they can cause us to go through the day robbed of joy and robbed of energy. Do you realize that the last words that our spouse or our children or grandchildren hear us before we start our day in the morning can affect them for the rest of the day? Do we realize that the words that we speak that are filled with love and compassion will give our family and those who are close to us confidence and enable them to do what they are supposed to do and live an accomplishing life throughout that day? See, I don't think we fully understand and recognize the tremendous power of our words. See, we need to understand our world is influenced by the words that we hear and the words that we speak. If you look in the book of Genesis, how was this world created? How did everything that we see today come into existence? God spoke and it happened. When God spoke, there was power in the words that he spoke. His words were so powerful. When he said, "Let there be light," there was light. When he said, "Let the earth bring forth the living creatures," the earth brought forth the living creatures. Everything was there. When God spoke, it came to pass. See, why is it that some children grow up well and strong and they work their way through college and then go on out and succeed at life? A lot of times it is because the right words were spoken to them. They were encouraged. They were motivated by their parents when they were growing up. You know, we cannot afford to talk failure and doubt over our children and over our grandchildren, because when you tell someone that they're no good, when you tell someone that they're not going to amount to anything, chances are that individual is going to grow up feeling that they are worthless, that they're no good, and they'll never make anything out of themselves. We're seeing a perfect example of that in what's taking place in our nation today. People are now being told that, you know, your vote does not make any difference because everything's being rigged. And so a lot of people are saying, "Well, I'm not going to vote because my vote doesn't make any difference." Why did they come to that conclusion? It's because they've been told that. Someone told them that they were not making a difference, so therefore they've given up. See, what we say to our family and send them off to succeed, or we can send them off to fail. If we tell people long enough that they're no good, or if we tell them that they're a failure, they're eventually going to start living up to what we have told them. Sometimes mischievous children are told that they're going to wind up in prison, and many of them do. And if people keep telling a child that they're no good and will never amount to anything, oftentimes those people become right. Why? It's because of the words. Over a period of time, the words that you speak began to come to fruition. If you continue to pour negativity into someone's life, that negativity is going to become fruitful into their life, and they're not going to be able to live the way God wants them to live. Now, I understand people have a personal responsibility to make the right choices in life. And I encourage you and those that's watching online, I encourage you, watch your mouth, watch your text messaging, watch what you put on social media, because the words that you speak have an effect on your life and in the lives of those around you. That's why we need to speak words that edify, speak words that build one another up and not tear them down. And don't repeat gossip that we hear. Don't poison other people's ears the way that your ears were poisoned when the gossip was told to you. You know, sometimes it wouldn't hurt to remind people that your ears are not garbage cans. Your ears does not need to hear that filth. You're not interested in their gossip. And the Word of God does not tell us, the Word of God tells us not to talk about people's mistakes. But it's quite the opposite in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. It says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted." See, that's our job, according to the Word of God. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, the Bible says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things." When you think on the things that's written in the Word of God, and you begin to speak the Word of God, and I'm all about speaking by faith and declaring by faith and believing by faith. But we also need to use common sense and understand that, yes, we do know the Word of God says, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. That's just it. Our needs, not our lustful desires, not our selfish ambitions. He says he shall supply all of our needs. And so when we look in the Word of God and we ask according to the will of God, and we see by faith what God has already told us in his word. As I mentioned this morning, we read in the word of God where he says, he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. With the stripes we are healed. Right there is a moment in our life that we can declare and we can name it and claim it in the name of Jesus and say, by faith I can be healed because his word says, by his stripes we are healed. By his stripes we are healed. We can call upon the name of the Lord because in his word we see what is there. And when we speak by faith according to the word of God, according to the will of God, God will bring it to pass. And so whatever we speak, whatever we say, whatever we do it all to bring glory and honor to God. Whenever I was called into ministry, and I began to go out and to preach at different churches and had opportunities to go sing. We had a few friends of ours got together. We had a gospel trio. We sang at different churches. But always had a commitment that when I'm in ministry, I'm not in the business to please people. I've listened to the advice of many pastors, and they always say, you cannot please everybody. It's so true. It's so true. You cannot please everybody. Anytime that you deal with people, whether in public, on the job, at church, wherever you're at, you're dealing with public, you're always going to have someone that's not happy, someone that's not satisfied. And so when I went into ministry, I made a commitment and I said, I'm not going to be in the business of trying to please people. Because if you're in a church, and the larger the church, the more problem you're going to have. But you're going to have Sister Bertha Lou better than you sitting over here on this side of the church. And she wants the pastor to preach on this particular subject and to sing this particular song. And then you have Sister Martha that's smarter. She wants the pastor to preach more of a encouraging message and not a hellfire brimstone. And she thinks we got to do away with all the old hymns and sing modern choruses. Well, if I did what Sister Bertha Lou wanted, someone over here is going to be very mad and upset. But if I did what Sister Martha wanted, Sister Bertha Lou is going to be very mad and upset. Soon you're going to have a squabble and someone's going to say, well, I told the pastor to do so-and-so. And they said, well, I told the pastor to do so-and-so. It'd be a whole lot better off if the pastor didn't do what any of them said and just do what the Lord said. Amen? Amen. Amen. And so that's what I determined. I said, Lord, I'm not going to try to please the people, but my desire is to please him. And that should be the desire of everyone in this room, everyone watching online by internet. Don't worry about what people think. People are going to say what people say. People are going to do what people do. We have a higher power. We have a higher authority. We have Jesus Christ to please with our life. And if we will live our life according to his word, Jesus said, he said, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. That's all that matters, to please him, to be like Jesus. There's an old song that says, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. All I ask is to be like him. From all throughout life's journey, from earth to glory, all I ask is to be like Jesus. And that should be our prayer. Lord, would you help our tongue to bring glory and honor to your name? Would we pray that God would strengthen our life, that the life that we live could be a reflection of who Jesus Christ is. He's created us in his image. We might as well live in that image. We might as well live in his likeness, live in his word. Let the words that we speak be words that would glorify him. A really great friend of mine, in fact, probably I could say a role model, would be my former associate pastor, who today at Van Buren First Assembly is being honored with his retirement after 40 years of ministry. But I never will forget a story that he told all of our church bus workers at a meeting one night. He said, do everything that you can to be like Jesus. Let everything that you do be what Jesus would do. Let your life be lived in such a way that when people see you, they see who Jesus is. And he told the story about one Saturday as he was driving a church bus, picking up kids. Now you have to understand, in this part of Fort Smith, it's very run down. I call it the ghetto. I mean, you never know who is going to be picked up at that house, because each week someone else lived in that house. You never knew who was going to come to the door. We were driving a bus in one of our neighborhoods that was used to having drive-by shootings. One Saturday, I drove the bus through there. It was a standard stick shift bus, and whenever I shifted the gears, the bus let out a loud pop and backfire. 35 people out there on the street, as soon as that bus backfired, every one of them hit the sidewalk. They thought they was all being shot at. That's the kind of neighborhoods I'm talking about, and the circumstances that these kids were coming from, where these kids are told by their parents that you're dumb, that you're stupid, that you're never going to amount to anything. And some of these parents have told their kids, you know, we'd been better off not even having you in our family. We'd been better off without having a child. What a terrible thing to say to a young boy or a young girl. But for moments of time, we could pick these kids up on a bus. And those that work in our children's ministry and our outreach ministry here, the time that you spend with these kids could be all the encouragement they get in a week's time. Whether if it's on Wednesday, whether if it's on Sunday, we have 1 hour that we can let them know that Jesus Christ cares for them, that he loves them, that he wants the best in their life. And I never will forget that Saturday, Brother Gary was telling us that as he was taking these kids home, they'd had a wonderful time on the bus. They would play games. They would sing, have a Bible story on the bus on the way to church. They'd get to church for an hour. They would sing and worship and have an object lesson. Hundreds of kids there. But we did everything we could on the bus to show one-on-one treatment of each of these kids. This five-year-old child, as they was letting this kid off the bus, turned around as they stepped down off the bus, looked up at Brother Gary and said, "Bye-bye, Jesus. I'll see you next week." Let other people see Jesus in you. That's my prayer. God, would you help me to be like you? Would you help me to speak like you? Would you help me to have the love and the compassion that only Jesus could have? And when we place the Word of God in our heart, and when we let the Holy Spirit lead us and guide us and direct us, we will be like Jesus, and we will be what God has called us to be, and to do the work that he's called us to do. Can we stand together across the sanctuary? Lord, we thank you tonight for your Word. We thank you, Lord, for this message that we have studied in the book of James. And God, if we could ever learn to control our mind, our thoughts, Lord, that we could control what comes into our life, then what goes out would be so much easier. And Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us, from the oldest to the youngest, to all of those that's gathered in this sanctuary, to those that are watching online. God, I pray that you would help us to be like you. Lord, to study your Word, to know the Scriptures, so that when temptation comes, we have a Scripture to back up why our answer is no. So that when the enemy comes in like a flood, you will raise up a standard against it. Lord, help us to have that determination to say that we are going to serve you no matter what. We're going to live for you regardless of what the enemy does, regardless of what the world says, regardless of what people try to do. We're going to live for you. We're going to be committed to you. And Lord, I thank you, Jesus. And Lord, we pray for your guidance, for your direction. God, that you would help us, Lord, to serve you with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our might. Lord, not to lean on our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledge you, God, that you would lift us up, that you would plant our feet on higher ground, God, that we would live according to your Word and continue in your Word and be obedient to your Word, because your Word is truth, and you said we would know the truth and the truth would set us free. And Lord, we thank you for that truth, and we bless your name forever.
Thank you for watching today. If we have reached you, we would like to hear from you. You can visit us online at howag.com Or you can write to us at First Assembly of God, P.O. Box 97, Howe, Oklahoma, 74940. We invite you to worship with us at First Assembly of God, Sunday morning Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship at 10:40, Sunday evenings at 6, and Wednesday evenings at 7. We also invite you to subscribe to our online YouTube channel or visit our Facebook page. We hope that you can join us again soon for another service from First Assembly of God in Howe, Oklahoma.